if a pair of identical twins marries another pair of identical twins, will their kids be identical? Ever thought about this one? I had to answer this when I was a high school biology teacher. Now that I'm a professor at the Technion, Israel Institute of Technology, and I study science education and science communication for over a decade, I still find these curiosity questions fascinating. My personal favorite is, does the whale have a belly button? These questions led me ask, what is it that people want to know about science? And why? Can we use what people want to know about science in order to teach them what we, as educators, want them to know about science? This way, making science education so much more relevant for people in all ages and all walks of life. Interest is highly important in science education. First of all, people who are interested pay attention long enough for learning to take place. Kids who are interested in science are much more likely to take advanced studies in science and scientific careers. This is important for us as a society because this is the next generation of the scientists and engineers. But there's another reason why we teach science to everybody, not just the kids who want to be scientists one day. And that is that each and every one of us needs some science knowledge in order to make real-world decisions in our lives. My kid has the flu. Should I give him antibiotics? What is genetically modified food? How is it different from other crops? Just to give two examples. So how can we tell if we are giving people the science information they need and want to know? Well, within science education, we solve usually this problem instantly. We simply don't care what our students want to know. Science educators, teachers, curriculum developers, they all want to give students a relevant curriculum, student-centered materials. The problem is, they define relevance from their own perspective. In a way, they're saying what the educational system thinks should be meaningful and interesting to students. This line of thinking had the outcome of repeatedly we coming up with a list of things that every person in this science-rich, technology-based society should know about science. We test to see if students know it. They do not. We're disappointed. We implement an educational reform. We test again, and we are disappointed again. But what if you got it all wrong? If you're saying that the reason we teach science to everybody is that they have to use science in their own lives, in their own non-science public and private life, then it logically follows we should turn to life itself, to these non-science situations, to see what people need and want to know about science. And there is so much people want to know. Let's start with students, for example. Doesn't it make sense that a relevant curriculum would actually address the things that students want to know? Well, in one of our studies, we asked high school students to write down their own questions on topics, three topics, from the biology curriculum. We took these hundreds of questions that they wrote down, things they want to learn about, and we gave them to some experienced high school biology teachers. And we asked the teachers, are these questions being addressed by the content that you have to teach? Their answer was very troubling. Only half of the questions that the students asked about the same topics that they are teaching, genetics, reproduction, whatever, were answered, were addressed by the curriculum. All the rest, hundreds of questions, will not be touched in class unless the teacher decides to teach more than he or she has to. So I'm asking you now, in what way is a curriculum relevant if it ignores and marginalizes the interest of those it needs to serve? And there is so much students want to know about science. How come we drink liquids in also different colors, but urine is always yellowish? Is it possible to tame a lion and turn it into a vegetarian? How come we don't feel we are growing up? And very importantly, when you go on a diet, where does the fat go? It would be very wrong of us to say that these are stupid questions. Or, as I once heard a teacher say, if we answer your questions all day long, we would not have time to learn. This is the way to learn. In my research group, we developed a way to unleash the power of students' interest within science class and use their question within science teaching. Do you remember the question about the pairs of the identical twins? Well, isn't that a beautiful trigger to talk about meiosis, recombination, nature versus nurture? How come the sun burns? We can use that to speak about combustion, about nuclear fusion. Just like a shadow government that gives voice to parties currently not in office, our shadow curriculum gives voice to those who have no power upon deciding what the formal curriculum will include, but are the ones who are most influenced by it. The shadow curriculum takes the existing curriculum and maps into it students' interests. It allows teachers to find out what their students want to know and will give them the ability, the information and activities that they can use in order to bridge students' interests and national requirements. But people are not students forever. Actually, most of their lives, they are not students. And when adults need some information about science and technology, they go to the internet. This is the primary source of information about science and technology. Queries that people put on search engines are very much like questions. They can tell us what kind of information people are interested in having and need to have. What is it that they are looking for? Can we use this type of questions to gain information on what people are looking for? So in another study we did, we used publicly available data about searches on Google. We found out that many of these searches has to do with school or university content. They are performed during the academic year. But many times, people hear or read something in the media and they get so interested that they just go online to search for more information. Just because they want to know more. What is it that they want to know more? Can we use this data in order to help them pursue their own goals instead of trying to shove science down their throats, science that they perceive as uninteresting and irrelevant? See, for example, what happens when there is a new Nobel laureate, new Nobel Prize winner. So when Dan Shechtman won the Chemistry Nobel Prize in 2011, well, first of all, there was this surge of media interest. His name, mentions of his name in Google News went up from almost zero to almost 3,000 in a matter of 10 hours. But something else happened at the same time. Do you see this surge of interest? That's users searching for Shechtman and for quasicrystals, a key scientific concept in his work. So the media event, the Nobel Prize announcement, created a teachable moment, a short window of opportunity in which people became interested in the underlying science. And this is not happening only with Shechtman. The same phenomena happened with other Nobel winners as well. And it doesn't have to be an academic event. Do you remember when actress Angelina Jolie announced her preventive mastectomy? Look and see what happened to searches for BRCA mutation. Do you see this surge of interest? This window of opportunity, this teachable moment for learning about the underlying science? We're approaching the end of my talk now. By now, I believe that I convinced you that many people, adults, teens, children, are interested in science. And we should build on this interest, capitalize in a flexible way on these teachable moments in order to open the door for meaningful learning to take place. How? Well, different educators can choose the strategy and the intensity with which to bring students' voice into their class. To me, what's important is the principle. Science education should be relevant. It cannot be relevant if it marginalizes the interests of those it needs to serve. So, does a whale have a belly button? Well, of course it does, it's a mammal. It used to have an umbilical cord. And isn't that a wonderful way to start talking about mammalian reproduction? Thank you.